Sardis actually looked out of the valley, and he saw the army gathered there, and he said, okay, we don't worry about them, because there's no waking up here. So the whole city went to sleep, a victory, and next thing that happened is they woke up in the morning, and realized the city was conquered. And what happens, one by one, each of the soldiers climbed the steep wall, and they conquered the city when Sardis was asleep. What happened is their complacency caused them not to watch, and their complacency was the reason for their defeat. And so the Lord speaking to the church of Sardis, and he said, the church of Sardis, he has sent spirits of God in the seven stars as a nation that you are alive, but you are dead. Had a reputation. The city of Sardis had a reputation to know them, and they rest on that reputation. And what happened is they came and defeated them. The same kind of thing was happening. The church of Sardis was likely part of the revived spread of Ephesus under the ministry of Apostle Paul, station 3 years. So what probably happened? Three people came to Sardis. They were a part of the move of the Holy Spirit. People were getting saved, people were getting baptized, people were getting discipled. What happened is the church of Sardis began to grow complacent because they rested on the reputation of the revival center. And what happened? They slide 40 years later. But you are dead. After them, wake up. There's no doubt in my mind, the Lord is speaking to them from their historical background as the sea, and just like Sardis, they would come, tell the sea walls, conquer you because of your complacency. If you don't wake up, I'm going to come like a thief, and I'm going to take the reward that you could have away from you. And he said in verse 2, wake up, strengthen the things that remain, which are to die, for I have not found your deeds completed in the sight of my God. And we're going to do this in a lot more detail, and I'm just going to read through it now. So remember what you have received and heard, and keep it, and repent. And here's what's interesting here. And there's no doubt in my mind the Lord is looking at what happened in the city in the past. He's saying, therefore, if you don't wake up, you can leap like you did when Cyrus attacked your city. If you go into complacency like you did when Cyrus came to attack your city, if you fall asleep, he said, I'm going to come like a thief. I'm going to come like a thief night. My second coming to the earth is going to be like a thief in the night. You're not going to know what hour I'm going to come you. And what that means is, you're going to suffer eternal loss. Doesn't mean you lose your salvation. But you're going to suffer eternal loss of eternal rewards because you're not ready, because your complacency caused you to miss the best God has for you. And he said, you know, you're not going to know what hour I come upon you. But you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments. So there was a remnant in Sardis that had not grown in complacent. There was a remnant in Sardis that had not grown apathetic or indifferent. And here the Lord says to them, they haven't soiled their garments. In other words, he's speaking with a bridal language here, and he's saying that that sin and compromise has not defiled their garments. Their white garments have not been defiled by compromise. And he says, this remnant in Sardis, they are going to walk with me in white, which is the same thing as a bride walking down the aisle with her bridegroom. He's basically saying, this remnant in Sardis is going to be married to me. And he said, because they are worthy. And he gives us the promise here. He who overcomes will be clothed in white garments. And I'm going to stop there just because I want to focus on a few things. We'll get into some of the other stuff a little bit later, but I want to focus on the message to the church of Sardis. What is the message? How does it apply to us? And I think there's about four things here that the Lord is calling his people to overcome, is relying on our reputation. We're on page 2 in our notes, relying on our reputation. If you've ever been to, how many people have ever been to London and ridden the tube? Few people. Okay, if you haven't ever been there, what happens is when you're approaching the tube, in most proper British English, there's this thing going over and over and over, mind the gap, mind the gap, mind the gap, mind the gap. I mean, it just goes over and over and over, mind the gap, mind the gap, mind the gap. You don't understand, all you got in your mind is mind the gap. Well, see, what happened, what the warning is, there's a little gap between the train and the station platform, and the warning is, watch out for that gap so you don't fall in and hurt yourself. And in the church of Sardis, there was a gap. And the Lord is speaking to the church of Sardis, and he's saying there is a gap between your reputation and your reality. You have a reputation, you're alive. You have a reputation for being a revival center. You have a reputation that's here, and your reality is that you're here. There's a gap that exists between your reputation and your reality, and you need to close that gap. He says to the church of Sardis in verse 1, he says, you have a reputation. I like the interview. You have a reputation that you are alive, but you are dead. And so what I think, you know, when I think about, and I remember when me and Dad went to Africa a few years ago, and we came back the Lord laid this message so strongly on my heart for our church. And I believe it's one of those messages that we are going to be fighting to overcome for the rest of our life. Is we have a reputation in Africa. We have a nation, our church has a reputation in Africa. Because of high school, because of the impact, we have this reputation in Africa of being this incredibly on fire, I think we are great, by the way, but it's incredibly, you know, on fire revival center with worship. I mean, I think we have a lot of that, so don't misunderstand me. I'm putting my foot in my mouth here. But there is a gap, especially when we got blessed, but this time it's not a gap. I don't want to stone his toes necessarily. But basically what pastors in Africa were saying is we want to come to your church and we want to see what it looks like to have law school fully intimate people. And me, I go, well, okay. Do you like law school material? And I'm kidding. There is a gap between reputation in Africa and our reality in America. We're known as whole spirit movement of hear God with miracles and unbelievable like throne worship. We do throne worship. And we're a bride making ourselves ready and all this stuff. And it's for me as well. By far it's for me as well. That we've got to be at the forefront to what we teach Africa. Our reputation in Africa and our reality in America, they're joined together. There's no gap. You understand what I'm saying? Is that when they would not go, well, I'm in this here, I've been five days, passionate worship and, you know, hearing God's voice and, you know, a bride making herself ready. But there's a gap there. Okay? We don't want to have a gap. We're leaders of a movement in Africa. And the Lord's saying, you can't have a gap between your reality and your reputation. Make sense? That's not something, when I say worship, I'm talking, the worship team is absolutely incredible. I'm talking about us as a congregation pressing into the presence of God. You got what I'm saying? We don't have lukewarm worship. We have passion. We have enthusiasm. We are pressing into God to take hold of the fullness of his presence. Amen? So it's not about the worship team. It's about us as worshipers. I'll just make that clear. Love you, Drew and Bethany. But we are getting better. We are getting better. But my point is this, is that the message to Sardis is our reputation, the way we're known, cannot see what is actually real in our lives. It applies to the teacher. It applies to us as fellowship. It wants to close that gap so that who we are and what we teach is the same thing how us live. So we can't rely on our reputation. And I could go down many, many examples of different organizations where there's a gap between where their founders are on fire for God and that organization sure it is now. I mean, I had some of this and I was like, well, right, I'll buy a fence and I'll take out. But, you know, I think Francis Chan said it well. Page 2, point D. He says, a movement starts when the founder really knows Jesus. You know how a movement dies? Is when the followers only know the founders. And so Sardis, what happened is the church leaders in the revival movement in Ephesus, they knew Jesus. They were instructed by probably Paul and John and some of them. The people that came after them, the leadership in the church, they did not know the Lord. And so the church became a graveyard of what it used to be. And the Lord says, you have a reputation for being here, but in reality, you are here. And he says, you must overcome the gap. Number two, page number 3 in your notes. Complacency. Drew once marked that most people are defeated by their secondary successes. That's a great quote. Defeated by their secondary successes. The problem with Sardis was this. Sardis grew complacent. And I think probably the best example of one who is not complacent is Nick Saban. And so how many people know who Nick Saban is? Okay. Football coach of Alabama. I've never seen or fighting against complacency than Nick Saban. Was a national champion of 2009 over Texas, Alabama. And I remember I was watching it, and he wasn't even smiling. I mean, he was sitting here, just won the national title, and he wasn't even smiling. And I think he was saying, you know, well, we didn't play that good. And you won 37-21. He's thinking about his next titles. I think he's won 4 out of 7 national titles because he fights against complacency. He doesn't let satisfaction gain and affect the way his team lives and operates. And the Church of Sardis had grown complacent. The Church of Sardis rested on their reputation. They rested on their success. They rested on the fact they were filled with the Spirit 40 years ago, but they were now dead, and their complacency, they're satisfied them not to press into the will of God now. And the Lord's saying, the Church of Sardis, he's saying to us, is that we have to fight against complacency. We have to fight against complacency. So many believers get complacent, and I've seen it. I've seen it in my own life. I've seen as I've looked at different people in the body of Christ, is any thousands of Christ, or hundreds of Christ, or Seawide Revival, or do these incredible worship albums, or books, or plant churches. And what happens is they die in the way God has used them in the past, and they become complacent and self-satisfied, and that hinders them from pressing into the high God. And the Lord is saying, Lazarus, don't get complacent. Don't get complacent in what you've accomplished. Don't get complacent in what you've done. Don't get complacent in the revelation you've even learned. Don't get complacent because you've brained 600% impact at 100,000 people in life school. Don't get complacent because you've got some revelation that's profound. We've got to keep pressing on until we achieve the high call of God. Christ Jesus to be worthy of our earning sons. So the Lord looks down. And Sardis, he says, you've grown complacent. I think that the greatest fights we have to fight as believers is to guard against complacency. I think when that happens, it's a revelation from the Lord, and it's a revelation from the Lord. What happens is this revelation from the Lord all of a sudden leads to spirit pride, and they begin to take pride. In fact, God has revealed to them. They don't know it. It's happened to me. I can say this from experience. They don't even know it, but they become satisfied in this revelation thought instead of pressing on to the fullness of God. See, we can't let pet doctrines, you know, we can pick up a doctrine on race, or revival, or rest God, or hearing God's voice, or the end times, a thousand things. We can't let those pet doctrines keep us from intimacy and an intimate relationship with Jesus. He's the goal, not our doctrines. He's the goal, not our revelation. We can't satisfied and confident that we have this insight, this understanding, and let it hinder us from pressing in to the high calling of God. Huge issue around the world, it really is. I mean, I've seen people where they learn God speak and they prophesy, but they just kind of hang out there and settle there forever and never move beyond hearing God speak to what some of the other were. I mean, I get no spirit rest. I've seen so many people get a true revelation of spiritual rest. It's important. Take my yoke upon me, upon you, learn me, for you'll find rest for your soul. It's exciting to know spiritual rest is very important. But they become complacent in that revelation amount with prayer and fasting and giving and sacrifice, and that complacency hinders them from pressing with God. And they've become so aroused in a coma. And that's why the Lord says to the church of Sardis, wake up. We can't be satisfied or place it in a revelation. So it happened in the prosperity gospel, so that they don't keep going on to the upward call of God Christ Jesus. And so the Lord's saying to the church of Sardis, he said to us, don't settle. Remember Babylon. Babylon was started in Genesis 11:2 when the settlers came to the city of Shinar. They settled there. Once they settled, Babylon ended up springing up. So when they settle anywhere, be aware that the next thing that eventually that can lead to this place where this remnant in Sardis has soiled their garments because settling leads to complacency, which leads to us missing the high calling of God. We have to fight against complacency. Amen? I think, even in our retirement, you know, we retire and we think, okay, I worked 30 years to make it where I am. It'll be so easy just to camera talk. I'm going to go play with the grandkids. I'm going to go play golf. I'm going to go travel around and get complacent. We can't. In our retirement, you never really retire from the kingdom of God, by the way. And so in our retirement, we cannot get complacent. We have to fight against complacency. We have to fight really we realize it. We have to fight against that complacency that wants to keep us satisfied with status quo, satisfied with the maturity we have, satisfied with the revelation we have. We can't stop until Christ has been formed, happen until we die and we go to hell. So in other words, we have to fight complacency for the rest of our life. Now look on page 5. Difference. Complacency is satisfaction in our accomplishments, our understanding, our revelation. Indifference is when there's a lack of difference to me. See, Angie is indifferent to win the game. She could care who wins the ball. She could care less if Joel wins or Tech wins or whatever. She could really give a care less. The only issue is not that. That's the only reason she has interest. There's indifference to her and her related to football. She just doesn't care. See, so many of us, like the city of Sardis, you would never say, well, I don't really care. But actions reveal that we don't care. I think indifference is probably a great battle as a church about base, especially in the comps of America, where indifference settles into our heart and we go, well, it doesn't, you know, we would never ever. But when at the end of the day we look at our actions, they testify that we're indifferent to the call of God in our lives. How many of us, there are so many things we look at that reveal we're just indifferent. And let me give you a couple here. Point F is, if we have the time to spend in prayer or in worship, it doesn't really bother us. That means we're growing indifferent. It doesn't matter if what is preached on Sunday, a big one for us, if I'm only getting about 10%, so here's what we'll do. We'll listen to me talk or dad talk or Randall talk, and we'll be like, wow, that was a good message. I don't understand some of this or understand some of that. And so what happens is we don't really do anything about the fact that we're getting about 10%. We're not going and investigating and getting that word in our heart that we can have the same relationship that's being preached from this pulpit. That's called indifference. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't bug us. I mean, it's just like, yeah, okay, you're good. I agree with it. I don't have it in my heart. That's a sign that we're indifferent. silent here, quiet. It's a big one here, by the way. Huge. But I love you. Indifferent to what is being preached. Okay, good message. I like what you said, that one point you made, that story was great. How Anna went to the neighbor's house and said that to the person about staying out late. That was funny, ha-ha. But the message, the truth, is not getting in our heart. We're indifferent. And it doesn't really bother us. We would never say that. We're indifferent. If we feel God's presence in worship, or if we don't, it's kind of like, okay, well, I'm going to watch a game, turn to Publix, curly fries from Arby's. But if we don't experience God, it doesn't affect us that much. We're indifferent. It doesn't affect us if we don't walk out Monday to Saturday what is being taught on Sunday. It's just like, okay. If we're not serving the vision of a local church so that Jesus' mandate can be fulfilled, if all we are doing is coming as a spectator Sunday after Sunday, amen right now. We want some servants in the house. We're not serving the local church, and it doesn't really affect us. It might mean we're raised from this. It doesn't matter. Here, this is probably the biggest one in our church right here, this one. It doesn't matter. Piling of God is the primary vision for my life. Okay, Brian talks about it, and Ken talks about it, and it's in the life school material. You're not even when he has a high calling of God, I don't even know what that means. I don't know. It's over my head. Whew, he's deep. We don't do anything about it. We don't change life to revolve around calling. Everything I'm talking about in this upcoming routine is going to take us a lifetime to fill. It is a life vision. But it doesn't shape us to go, okay, I am changing my life. I am causing this vision to revolve around my life. I mean, I am making it the center of my life. If we don't feel that way, if we're not moved by that, we're like, yeah, I must agree with it. Don't do anything about it. It only reveals our indifference. There's indifference in our heart. There's indifference in our heart. And God wants to get that indifference out of our heart so we can keep progressing to the calling of God. I love what Elie Wiesel, who's a Holocaust survivor, point D here, said about indifference. He said, the opposite of love is not hatred, but indifference. So we think we love God, we think we love Jesus. When we're indifferent to his word, we're indifferent to what it says, we're indifferent to what he commands us to do, then that means we don't really love him like we thought. And the Lord said in the last days, the love of many is going to grow cold. And that word in Greek means to grow cold gradually and imperceptibly, as when you blow on hot food. And you blow on it, and slowly and gradually, it begins to cool off. And the Lord's warning the end time people, us, that if you're not aware, your heart can begin to grow cold and not even aware that it's happening. You're becoming indifferent. You don't even know. Noel from Australia, one of our spiritual fathers, has really been a blessing to our church over the years, says that divine seriousness is grandmaster key to making progress with God. There is a divine seriousness that we need. That doesn't mean we can't have fun or laugh or smile or whatever. It doesn't mean we have to have a scowl on our face, walk around depressed and heavy and, you know, all religious. But there is a seriousness that we need. I mean, to be an overcomer, to be the bride who's made herself ready, it requires serious devotion and focus. We can't just casually think we're going to be there, you know, fulfill high, you know, be the inheritance that God wants and not take it serious. We've got to take it serious. It has to be our life. It has to be our life. Quiet in here. Page 6. Carelessness and negligence. See, when we lack divine seriousness, when we're kind of casual about the things of God, most of the church in America is extremely casual about the things of God. Just kind of like Jesus is the hippie, the coolest hipster. Extremely casual about the things of God. When we have divine seriousness, we can easily become careless and negligent. The writer of Hebrews says that we got to pay much closer attention to what we've heard so that we don't drift away from it, so that we don't neglect so great a salvation, so that we don't have our heart without even knowing it grow cold and fall in unbelief. And even apostasy of falling away from God. See, we have to pay as a church at Restoration Life. We need to pay so much closer attention to what we're hearing. A lot of us heard things, but we haven't heard things. It's like we have silly putty on our ear, a wax on our ear. We've heard it, but we haven't heard it. We're forgetful hearers rather than effectual doers. We can become negligent in the things. That's what happened to Sardis. I mean, you can imagine over their 40-year history, they had many mature leaders come to that church and speak into that church and teach that church. I mean, we don't know, but Paul could have very likely gone to that church. Or one of his mentors, one he mentored could have gone to that church. John could have gone to that church. I mean, they would have heard an enormous amount of truth revelation over a 40-year journey. Yet notice what the Lord says to them. Remember what you have heard. They forgot. They had forgotten because they grew negligent, because they weren't paying attention to what the Lord had been speaking over history. They grew negligent. They grew careless. And so what happened, the Lord says to them, remember what I've spoken to you. Remember what you've received. Remember what you have heard. And then keep it. It's not enough to be a hearer of the word. We have to do the word. And I believe even the church, we have heard. We have heard. And even the life mentors who are going to hear this, heard, and even me teaching this, I'm speaking to myself, I promise you. We have heard, but we become forgetful. And we're like, oh yeah, I forgot about that. What it means, we lack divine seriousness. Condemnation, okay? Don't anyone get a condemnation. I'm challenging all of us, including myself, to hire in God. Don't hear this as God's mad at me, unworthy, unterrible. I'm no good. No, that's not what I'm saying. Don't hear it as a challenge to us to go higher in God. Amen? So the Lord says in Revelation chapter 3, if you're starting to feel depressed, remember you get to eat a good meal after church today, okay? Revelation 3, verse 2, the Lord says, wake up. He's talking to the bride of Christ. He's talking to his betrothed bride. He says, wake up. See, the thing about sleep and slumber, if you don't know, you're asleep until you wake up. And sometimes we have someone come and wake us up out of our slumber. Now, I learned my lesson my first year of marriage. I learned from my dad. My dad would wake up sometimes and he would be like, okay, what a creative way I can make him up today. I go to school. I'll blow the chauffeur right up, throwing pills at him. But I learned that. And I brought it into my marriage. And I talked about marriage last Sunday. And you know, the first year was terrible. Well, part of the reason I learned that from my dad, and I would wake up Angela like, this is the day. And she'd be like, get out of here. But sometimes we need an obnoxious voice, like me and my dad, to sound alarm and say, it's time to wake up. Amen? America needs to wake up. Church America needs to wake up. We're in a slumber. We're apathetic. We're in a complacency, and we need to wake up. And the only way to wake up is to get out of bed, get some coffee. Sorry if you don't drink coffee, you should. Get some coffee, get the slumber out of your life, and realize who God has called you to be. And the Lord says to the church of Sardis, wake up. This word wake up. Let's look on page 7. This word wake up in the Greek, it means to watch, to give strict attention to be cautious, to be active. It's interesting that the Lord uses this word, I think it's used 30 times in the New Testament. This word in the Greek, Gregorio, I think that's how you say it. Gregorio is used 30 times in the New Testament, but over 25% of the time is used in an end time context. We live in the end times. One of the most urgent words from the Lord to us in the end times is wake up and watch. Watch. You know, the parable of the 10 virgins, all 10 of them fell asleep. Did you realize that? Not just the 5, foolish. All 10 fell asleep. But what had happened is the wise virgins had developed a history of watching and fighting against indifference and complacency and apathy in the place of prayer. This all comes down to the place of prayer. This all comes down back to the secret place of being vigilant in the place of prayer, of being awake in the place of prayer, of being alert in the place of prayer. It's an end time message to the Lord's bride, is that we need to wake up and we need to watch, because we don't know when the Lord is coming. And if we are asleep, just like in Sardis, we will be conquered like the Persians conquered Sardis. In other words, we won't overcome. And just like a thief comes and steals and takes away, we can suffer eternal loss. It doesn't mean we lose our salvation, but the incredible inheritance the Lord is offering to his people, we can forfeit that like Esau forfeited his birth. The Lord says, wake up. That's why the Lord says, awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. How many know we all need a little bit of waking up? How many know we all need a little bit of Holy Spirit caffeine to get the slumber out of our bodies? We need the slumber out of us, fully awake, discerning of the hour of history we live in. Because what happens when we get slumber, when we fall asleep, our garments, our bridal garments become defiled, just like the remnant in Sardis, they had defiled their garments. They had soiled their garments. Their garments were not white and brilliant and just spotless. They had been soiled because they had fallen asleep. When we grow complacent, apathetic, and indifferent, then our garments can be soiled and darkened by sin. Revelation 3, verse 5, the Lord says, the one who overcomes complacency, apathy, indifference, carelessness, negligence, the one who overcomes this, the Lord says, he or she will be clothed in white garments. Now, what does that mean? Well, I think the Lord is alluding to the remnant in Sardis, verse 4. He said, you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments, and they are going to walk with me in white, for they are worthy. There was a remnant in Sardis who's spotless, were pure, who had not been defiled. Now, we need to take a moment and really understand the white garments, because this is an eternal reward that Jesus offers everyone, but only the overcomers actually get the white garments. It's not about your eternal salvation. It's about your eternal destiny. So let's look at this. Revelation 19:7. Let us rejoice and be glad and give the glory to him. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. The Lord is not going to make us ready by himself. The bride makes herself ready in cooperation with the grace of God, for sure. But we are the ones who make ourselves ready by the Holy Spirit's grace. And verse 8, it was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Now, I want you to look here, because John is telling us, okay, what is the fine linen? What is the white garments that Jesus gives to the overcomers? John is answering that question for us right here. Well, what does that mean? Well, this word, righteous acts, it comes from the same Greek word that Paul used in Romans chapter 3 through 5 to describe imputed righteousness that comes by justification by faith. It's the same word or it comes from the root word. And what it means is the works we do from our initial justification. The works we do from our righteous spirit. And see, you know, as we talk about righteous works, I have a fear that if we aren't fully grounded in the gospel, it will become legalism. Because we're not to work for righteousness. We're to work from righteousness. Huge difference. For love, we're to work from the reality that we're deeply loved by God, from our justification. We're not to work for approval, but from approval. In other words, from our born-again, imputed righteousness experience, we then do righteous works, love-motivated obedience, obeying the full counsel of God's word by the Holy Spirit's grace and power. And it comes out of the righteousness that God has imputed and imparted to us when we are born again. And the Lord's saying, this is your righteous works. These are your righteous acts. This will be the clothing you wear for all eternity. See, in the Jewish times, the Jewish bride would go, and she would go away for a year after her betrothal, and she would make her own wedding dress, stitch by stitch. I mean, she couldn't go to Dave's Bridal Store and buy a wedding dress. I mean, she couldn't go, what's that one show on, Say Yes to the Dress? She couldn't go on Yes to the Dress and get a wedding gown. She had to stitch by stitch make her own wedding dress. Now, can you imagine what would happen if the bridegroom came a year later and his bride had, you know, like half the dress was made? I mean, it would show the bridegroom that she didn't really care. It would show the bridegroom that she was negligent. I mean, how many believers in making our own wedding dress have allowed them to become defiled by sin and difference and compromise, or even worse, haven't done anything at all, and we're spiritually naked? And the Lord said in Revelation chapter 16, 15, wake up so that men will not see your shame and you will be naked. Have you ever had a dream where you are like, go to Target and you realize you're in your underwear in Target and you're like, oh my goodness, I'm in my underwear at Target? Has anyone ever had a dream like that? I don't know, maybe it's just me. Okay, some, yeah. Okay, don't try to envision me, I'm underwear, I'm at Target. So, just kidding. Yeah, get that out of your mind. Okay, think sandwiches, curly fries, think Italian subs and pizza. Okay, get that out of your mind. Here's the point, is we can be all eternity as if we're spiritually naked. In other words, people in eternity can look at us and know immediately this person lived for themselves rather than Jesus. Yes, they're in heaven, but they're spiritually naked. There's no righteous works that clothe them and cover them. And the Lord's saying, if you overcome indifference and complacency, you will get white garments to clothe, to be the clothing you wear for all eternity. It's really important how we live this life. Let's look at Revelation 22. Matthew 22. I want to show you the importance of having wedding garments, the importance of overcoming. And as you're turning there, let me just say this. I have never met a bride who gets ready for her wedding with, like, you know, kind of like out of obligation, begrudgingly, like, you know, out of fear or shame or condemnation. I mean, have you ever met a bride like that? It's very rare. I would hope they wouldn't even get married. But most every bride that is getting ready for their wedding has incredible joy, incredible happiness. I mean, they go to bed and they can't even sleep because they're so excited. They get up in the morning, the first thing they think about is their wedding that's coming up. I mean, why is that different in the body of Christ? We're going to be married to the bridegroom, God, Jesus. Why is it that so many believers turn getting ready for the wedding into dead religion, into incredible pursuit of our life? Our you know, even though it takes 50, 60 years to get ready, it is the passion and the drive and the consuming joy of our heart. That's the way it should be. It shouldn't be this begrudging yoke that we carry, gloomy and sad and feeling like God's mad. It should be incredible joy that we carry, knowing we are the betrothed bride of Christ. We are going to get ready for this wedding with joy and with gladness. Amen? But here in Matthew chapter 22, the Lord tells a parable. It's the parable of the marriage feast. It's absolutely describing the marriage supper of the Lamb. And here's what happens is the Lord sends out invitations and the invitations go out and there's a whole host of people that come to the wedding hall. And then all of a sudden this guest comes into the wedding hall and wedding garments, They're the very righteous acts of the saints of Revelation 19, 7 and 8. They're the righteous acts of the saints. So the wedding garments he offered to the church of Sardis. Notice what he says. The king says, he says in verse 12, he says, "Friend, how did you come in here without wedding clothes?" And he was speechless. And then they escorted him out of the wedding hall. He didn't lose his salvation. I'm going to explain that in the next session. He's put into the outer darkness. I'm going to explain that in the next session. He didn't lose his salvation. But here's what it shows us. It reveals to us what happens to those who are justified but not fully sanctified on that day. They're escorted out of the wedding feast. It's sobering. I mean, it shows you, though, the importance of obedience moved and empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's not fleshy, religious striving that we do. It is Spirit-led, grace-empowered obedience to the Word of God, the Holy Spirit's leading and power. But the Lord says, if you overcome complacency, indifference, and apathy, and carelessness, and negligence, and relying on your reputation, if you overcome that, you will get white garments, which is the garments of the bride, which is the righteous acts of the saints. You will receive those righteous garments so that you can walk with me and wait, for you will be worthy. Let's look at page 9 here in your notes. A Worthy Bride, released a few years ago. Excellent book if you haven't read it. But I love the phrase, a worthy bride, because every believer, 2 Corinthians 11:2, every single believer that has been born again is the Lord's betrothed bride. Every single believer. But not every believer will make themselves ready, will overcome. And not every believer will be a worthy bride of him. And I want to talk about that for a minute. Because the Lord says to the church, turn back to Revelation 3. The Lord says to the church of Sardis that those who are worthy are going to walk with him in white. I want to focus on the word worthy. And I know what the word worthy can do to people's emotions. Because everyone will go, okay, I'm unworthy and I'm unworthy. I'll never be worthy. And what can happen is yoke of condemnation, shame, guilt, religious bondage can come over them and they can feel unworthy. I just want to say that is not what this is about. The blood of Jesus has absolutely cleansed you from your past, destroyed every work of guilt, shame, and condemnation if you're a believer. The blood of Jesus has absolutely destroyed your past in terms of destroyed the bondage of your past, has liberated you from guilt, shame, and condemnation. His Spirit now dwells inside of you. Your spirit is just as righteous as his. Your heart has been cleansed. Your spirit has been made new. Your spirit is alive. And so what I'm talking about when we say worthy is we're talking about the salvation that is in our spirit being worked out into our heart and into our soul. It's about becoming Christ-like. That's what we're talking about. Is the Lord is going to have a worthy bride. I mean, have you ever seen, you know, I'm just going to use an example, but have you ever seen the 5'11 supermodel and she's like dating the 4'11 guy who's like 300 pounds balded? And you're like, how did he get her? I mean, have you ever seen that? And you're like, okay, he must be rich. You know, that's the first thing that comes to your mind. I mean, you're basically saying they're totally, you know, incompatible, okay? They don't fit together. The Lord is going to have a bride who fits with him. Look at your notes here. Point number D. This Greek word for worthy means having the weight of another thing. It can mean befitting, congruous, corresponding to a thing, of one who has merited anything worthy. Here's what it means. The wife of the Lamb will herself be a lamb. The wife of the Lamb will be humble and meek and obedient and self-sacrificing and have a servant's heart, just like the Lamb of God. The Father is not going to give Jesus a bride who is not worthy of him. Absolutely not. He's going to give the give him a bride that is just like him in nature, an exact representation of Christ in the earth. And he absolutely is going to do that. He absolutely is going to present the Lord Jesus Christ with a bride on that day who is worthy of him. And he has all the grace in the world to make you worthy of him. If you say yes, if you say yes to the dress. A little corny. Say yes to the dress, but it rhymes. Say yes to the dress. If you say yes to the dress, God's Spirit has enough power to make you ready of him and make you worthy of him and to make you a lamb who is meek and humble and self-sacrificing and filled with love just like Jesus. The bride of Christ will be an exact representation of Jesus to the Father. That's your vision. That's the goal that God has for all of our lives, is to become just like Jesus, to be worthy of him. And so the Lord goes through Matthew 10, 37 through 38. We're not going to turn there. But he says, if you love father or mother more than me, you're not worthy of me. If you love son or daughter more than me, you're not worthy of me. And basically says, if you don't take up your own cross and deny yourself, you're not worthy of me. If you don't even love yourself, or if you love yourself more than me, you're not worthy of me. The Lord is going to raise up a bride who is absolutely worthy of him. Page 10 in our notes. I want to talk about something that probably has not been talked about a whole lot, but it's the word, I want to talk about being approved for the high calling of God. Approved for the high calling of God. You know, when we talk about the high calling of God, we're talking about the overcomers, we're talking about the bride of Christ, we're talking about, you know, that's what we're referring to. That's what I believe is the scriptural meaning of that. In 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27, Paul is talking about the high calling of God, and he references it, or he alludes to a runner running a race, and he's saying this runner who's running a race is going after a perishable wreath, but you are going after one that's imperishable. And there's no doubt that Paul is talking about the same, it's the same Greek word, the same overcomer's crown the Lord offered to the church of Smyrna. And it's in that context Paul is without doubt talking about pursuing the high calling of God, that Paul says, point E down to the bottom of your notes, page 10, that Paul says, I discipline my body and make it my slave so that after I reach to others, I will not be disqualified. He's not talking about losing his salvation. He's not saying, I'm trying to use self-discipline so my salvation doesn't get lost. He's not talking about that at all. He's talking about the high calling of God. He's talking about being qualified for the high calling of God. And I want to give you confidence, you absolutely can be qualified for the high calling of God. But it will require your life. It will. But here, Paul uses a word, a Greek word, eidokimos, and it means not standing the test, not approved, unfit for. And so what Paul's saying is this, if I don't exercise self-discipline, I can preach to others about the high calling of God, but if I allow my flesh to rule over me, and allow my spirit to be suppressed to where my flesh, my unredeemed flesh, has the power and the leadership in my life, then on that day when I stand before the Lord, he will look at me and evaluate my life and say, saved, but unfit for the throne, unapproved, disqualified. Now, I want to look at this word for a minute because it's really an important word as it relates to the high calling of God, as it relates to the judgment seat, as it relates to being a worthy bride, you may or may not know this, but in the Greek, whenever there's an A in front of a word, it makes that word be the opposite. So in other words, if we look at dokimos, and I'm sure if someone was from Greece heard me say that, they would laugh. I guess that's how you say it, dokimos. If we look at that word dokimos, we understand that that word means accepted, pleasing, acceptable, and it was used of coins and money. In fact, back in that time, if they didn't have a banking system, and so they didn't have paper money, they basically took metal, they put the metal into a mold, and they whittled the excess metal from the coins. And so what happened is these money makers came in, and they were filled with fraud and deceit, and they would shave off more than was required. And they would take more weight from the money. And there was all these laws back then that would try to prevent that. But there was these men of integrity, and they were called the dokimos. Put the right money into circulation without taking advantage of the system. They were genuine. They were approved. And so the Lord uses this in this word, dokimos, in the context of the judgment seat of Christ. 1 Corinthians 3:13. I'm not going to turn there. But the quality of our work is going to be tested. Dokimos. It's the Greek word dokimos. The quality of our work is going to be tested. And based upon our works on this life, based upon how we let the finished work work itself out in our life, we will either be approved of this calling at the judgment seat, or we will be disapproved. And then James uses a derivative of this word in James 1:12. And he said, blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for when he has been approved, dokimos, he's going to receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. The same overcomer's crown offered to the church of Smyrna, approved at the judgment seat. And so it's very scriptural, even though it may not sound like the grace message you hear in most of the body of Christ. It's very scripture proved for the high calling of God. I want to qualify for the high calling of God. I don't want to be disqualified from the high calling of God. I don't want to be disapproved of the high calling of God. I know that sounds foreign to people who are under kind of some hyper-grace teaching, but it's absolutely fully compatible with the greatest grace teacher in the world, the Apostle Paul. He taught that. He himself said that. I don't want to be disqualified. That's why I exercise bodily discipline. So it's very scriptural to say that. Now, going back to the marriage supper of the Lamb, as Jesus said, many are called, but few are chosen. The called is the betrothed bride of Jesus Christ. Every believer is called because they are betrothed. Not every believer on that day will have made themselves ready, will have overcome and gotten the white wedding garments and be chosen. They will not be approved. They will not be worthy of him. Now, in Hebrews 12:17, I know this is quite a bit, another derivative of dokimos is used when it says that Esau was rejected, he was disapproved of the inheritance of his father. So Esau went to go get the birthright from Isaac, and Isaac said, I can't do it. I can't approve this request. So many believers are going to be Esau on that day. When they stand before the Lord, and they stand before the judgment seat, and the Lord says, you're unapproved for the firstborn, the inheritance of the firstborn son. You're still my child. You're still my beloved child. I love you deeply. I love you dearly. But you haven't been approved for this high calling. And my point is not to make this so lofty and high that no one ever can achieve it, because that's not true. You absolutely can do it by the grace of God. You absolutely can do it by the grace of God. I have so much confidence in God's grace. If you will say yes to the dress, if you will say yes to the Lord, if you will say yes to the invitation, I have a complete confidence in the grace of God that he can make you ready for that day. His grace is more than sufficient, more than powerful enough to conform you into the image of Christ if you say yes. Now, just saying yes is not enough. We have to discipline our lives. We have to discipline ourselves. We have to overcome and fight against complacency. But I want to give you confidence that you can do it by the grace of God. It's not so lofty and it's not so high that only like the Apostle Paul and the Apostle John can do it. It's available and it's doable by any born again. But I want to close this by saying, considering this, approval and worthy, unworthy, qualified, disqualified, how we live, whether or not we have divine seriousness, the way we live our life is critical, is vital to what happens in the next life, in the next age, and even now. Amen. Father, we come before you. Lord, I want to pray that you would get every bit of indifference out of our lives. God, I just confess there is indifference in my heart. I know there's indifference in our hearts. Lord, I know there's complacency. Lord, I just pray that we fight against complacency and apathy and indifference, and we would not let anything rob us of the high calling of God in this house. Father, let us be driven by eternity. Father, I pray that you would do a work in our hearts, Lord, even as we seal the fast in a minute with communion. Lord, I just pray that you would just difference. Lord, I pray that you would reveal to us every area where there's indifference, every area where there's complacency, Lord, every area where there's apathy, negligence, carelessness, Lord, and that you would release into our hearts a divine seriousness that would drive us for the rest of our lives, Lord. Set apart in this house a people who are making themselves ready with a seriousness in God that's uncommon in the Western church and the Western culture. Do it, Lord, in this house, that we would be divinely serious with incredible joy and laughter and gladness, but divinely serious about you and pursuing you and knowing you and pressing into you and being the bride you've called us to be and being the overcomers you've called us to be, Father. I just want to pray, do a work, Father, in us of getting the indifference and the cold love out of us. Lord, do a work, Father, I pray, in all of us, so we would be so on fire for Jesus that there would be no place for indifference in us, no place for self-satisfaction and pride of settling. We pray, Father. Do what we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
I want to lead us in communion and some ministry of the Holy Spirit. And, as the service is, as I was thinking in my mind about the service, I was thinking, okay, we had talked to Drew and Bethany about cutting worship a little bit shorter today. And so we'd have plenty of time to do what I just sensed the Holy Spirit saying. And in a good way, it's the service has gone long. And I thought, well, maybe we don't need to do what I was planning on doing. I asked for the kids to come back in. But then I thought, well, if we do that, listen to me now. We've all seen children walk through a room before. We'll be given into indifference. And I don't want to give into indifference because I really believe, and I know everybody's probably ready to go eat lunch and all that. But if we don't do this with all of our heart, nothing really will happen other than we'll go through a routine. But what I really sensed yesterday, I was really waiting on the Lord for as it relates to communion and what to do, was that the Lord wanted, as we are breaking the fast, before we break the fast, what the Lord wanted to do was not only for us to remember what Jesus did at the cross, but also to release a work of the Holy Spirit to break off things off of our lives. Issues like infirmity, not only physical infirmity, but issues in the soul realm, you know, inner healing types of things. So that's really what I really sense the Holy Spirit wants to do. But it's going to take a few minutes to do that. It won't be something we can rush through in, you know, 5 minutes or so. It'll probably take 20 to 30 minutes. But I think if our heart is in it, though, I think God will do some things. And so I'm not really asking, because I think that the Lord said not to do it, because that'd be given in, not to ask, because that'd be given into indifference. But I want to pray that our hearts would be there and to prepare our hearts, because I really believe God wants us more than just to eat a piece of bread and drink some juice in remembrance of the cross, but to really see the appropriation of the cross released in our lives. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to say another 30 minutes to see the Lord to do it? Okay. All right. Not too many people saying Randall said do it. Okay. Yeah. While we're doing it. Okay. All right. Well, let's start. I want to get Drew and Bethany and as much of the worship team who can to come up. And I want us to sing. I want us to worship for a few minutes. And then let me explain it. While you're coming up, I'll explain what we're going to do. What was on my mind was maybe the first song, but maybe not with it all, but maybe more slow. Can you do that? Okay. All right. Drew can do anything. Okay. Here's what we want to do. Now, it's important that we believe and that we are hungry for this, to see something really happen. But what I want us to do is I want to read some from Isaiah 53, which, you know, is the scripture in the Isaiah 50 scripture about the cross. And I want us to refresh by believing. And I want to just lead us, and I want us to lead us to, after we worship, to lead us to say, yes, I believe these things, to kind of stir our faith. And then we're going to take communion. And then after that, I'm going to play about a few minute audio from a Terry Bennett teaching that he taught up in his own church a few weeks ago, where it was more not really a teaching so much as a ministry, where he was releasing angels to go to war to bring a breakthrough over infirmity and issues like that. And I started to say, I was telling the Lord yesterday, I'll just say that. Then I really feel like, you know, there was such anointing on it when he did it that I would not be able to duplicate that particular anointing. So I want to just pray. I mean, I want just us to listen to that. And then we're going to, but I want you, as we do it, to act as though it's doing it to you. And you receive a breakthrough. Receive deliverance, receive healing, receive what the Lord wants to do. Because we've been through 21 days of fasting. Let's really do this with all of our heart and see what God will do to break off these things. Amen? Can we do that? Okay, so let's stand up and let's worship for a few minutes, and then we'll take that approach. Yes. Yeah, let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we just agree with me now. Father, we welcome you into this room. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. We want to see infirmity broken off. We want to see, Lord, not only even physical infirmity, but spiritual, emotional bondages.